like they're bitten by a poison.
Resonance 104.4 FM.
Well, look at this! Here's a guy here just in the nick of time. What does that make us?
Big damn heroes, sir.
Ain't we just?
In the year 2017, an innocent man accused of a crime has a choice. Hard time or prime time?
Good morning!
Morning!
Good morning!
Oh, and in case I don't see you, good afternoon, good evening, and good night.
Hello and welcome to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM, the film and TV radio show where a handful of film enthusiasts shoot the breeze about all things film and television. I'm Marcus E. Acko, and the last TV show film that I watched was Good Omens on Amazon Prime.
Welcome, it's David Campbell, and the last TV show I watched, I saw on catch up, it was actually The Planets.
Okay, we'll come to that in a second. With us in the studio, we have two guests, a return guest and a brand new guest. She's a reality TV show celebrity. Please tell us your name and the last thing that you watched on TV or film or anything.
Hi, my name's Lisa Appleton. I'm starring Big Brother, and the last TV show I watched was The Worst Dressed Celebrities of the World, a countdown from 100 to 1, and I was in number 6.
Okay, I'm going to talk. We're going to talk about that in a few seconds. Our other guests in the room, you are a return guest. Okay. Please tell us your name and the last thing that you watched on television.
I'm Bryn Curt James Hammond, Hall of Horror inductee of 2018, and the last TV show I watched was Kimishima's The Bunker Show. I'm not sure how you pronounce it, but it was about a nun in a bunker show, which then came out to New York. Hello. So it's great.
So wait, is that on Netflix?
Netflix, yeah. Kimishima.
Okay.
There's a bunch of people, like, they brainwash them.
Okay.
And then they go under a bunker.
Mm-hmm.
And then they go to New York, and he's like, hello. And
so like, so that's kind of like the reality TV show version of Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt, which is also...
Oh, my God, that's what I was just talking about.
Wait.
Hello, Kimmy Schmidt.
Oh, I'm sorry. Is that the show that you're talking about?
Yes, that's the last show I've just watched.
So the show is Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt.
Yes.
Okay.
Right, okay.
Welcome back, Bryn.
I'm so glad that you know him.
Hold on, Marcus. Did you like that show?
Love Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt.
Oh my God, so do I. Because, you know, Kimmy Schmidt,
yes,
was me.
Oh, okay. It
is, she is me.
You were trapped in a bunker?
No, my ex-boyfriend, I won't even say his name,
uh-huh,
but yes, we've already spoke about it.
Sure.
Anyway, 10 years, I was locked in a house in Wootton Drive, which is in...
Don't have to go there, yeah.
Well, who cares? Because it's a 6-bedroomed house in Northampton, and he still lives there with his new little bitch.
But then okay.
Hello.
But then you got liberated, and now you're living the best you, right?
No, he left the house and left me.
That's what I mean.
I got liberated, and I went to Birmingham, and then I was like, hello.
All right, so we might cover more of that later on. I want to come back to Lisa. Lisa Appleton, thank you very much for joining us today. So the show that you said... You watched was 100 Worst Dressed Celebrity.
Worst Dressed Celebrities in the World.
Uh-huh.
And I was watching it, and I was just chilling with a vino like you do, and a few pork pies and bananas. And then I didn't expect it, even though I'm in the media eye and I've hit press and magazines. And I was at number 6 as the worst dressed celebrity.
I'm
massively into fashion. I love fashion. I pride myself on. I'm 51. I think
she's not 51.
I'm 21 actually.
you don't look a day over.
For them to slate me with what I'm wearing, I mean, designers make me clothes. I wear some of the most amazing things.
Okay, so let me just interject there for a second. That's the point I'm trying to go for. Now, you were number 6 worst. What references did they use to demonstrate you as being the worst or the sixth worst? What references were they using? As in, sort of, what were you wearing that they said, have a look at what Lisa's wearing?
Probably a bin liner.
Was it that bad?
My personality is variety, spice of life. So okay. I don't wear, you won't see me wear, you can see me wearing a classy outfit and then the next day you can see me wearing something more casual or more outrageous. But variety, spice of life. So they were basically picking on my more outrageous outfits.
Uh-huh.
But I am very classy.
If you've watched.
So it might be like taking the bins out I go out in my dressing gown.
Sure.
I shop in my dressing gown because I feel free.
And that's
liberated.
What they used as evidence to say this is why you're the worst.
And I also have gone out to Anne Summer's party in bra and knickers.
Oh, well, that's sexual though.
And I've gone out in a mini dress that's actually because I'm a tall girl, I'm 6 foot, like Bridget Nelson. Uh-huh. And they show me with my mini dresses on where it's kind of risen up.
Sure.
And it's flashing a bit. But why don't they show me with a long, classy red carpet dress that I've mixed with so many stars on these red carpets and I look
because that
glamorous.
Is that then knocks you off the list. So they're trying to get people on
so
this.
So they're
okay.
using you for... They can up you or down you for whatever they want. It's
but
like,
can we just
you're
say...
Their, you're their puppet.
She's Understood. Got the most get amazing... It? Lisa's got the most amazing dress sense. We're going to the Spice Girls concert on Tuesday. And
yes, and I'm going classy.
I know.
Stop it. People are going to expect me to be wearing... Just excuse me, Bryn.
Yeah.
We're going to the Spice Girls concert. I can't wait. But they're going to be expecting me to be looking
outfits.
Like Ginger Spice in a flag and
oh, no,
looking like
Ginger
Posh Spice.
Spice.
And looking like Sporty Spice, okay. Baby Spice or... Or Scary Spice. But I'm actually going to go in
She's
something
sexy.
Completely different.
No, but she wears sexy like today. No, listen, because they
and
can't see.
And people won't expect it.
Of course.
These people can't see what
I'll tell
you're
what.
Wearing now.
And that's a very good point
that
Bryn has just raised. Because
you're sexy and
Thank
you're
so
wearing
much.
A really classy outfit
Thank
and
you
you're
so
gorgeous.
Much.
It is a very interesting point that you've raised there, Bryn. That, to be
it's
honest,
curves.
I would not have addressed you as being... the worst dressed celebrity because
oh God,
in our research we wouldn't have classified that
but
it's a very good interesting point that you brought in before we come back to you because we do have a number of questions that we want to ask about your current projects. Before we do that, I want to jump back to David. You mentioned what you watched recently. Please tell us more about it.
Well, if anyone remembers Brian Cox,
yep.
Things can only get better. D-Ream, he used to be a member of that band.
Uh-huh.
Every time
that
I see
band.
Him, I always think of that song.
Yeah.
And the Labour Party. And
he's not dead, no.
The Labour Party and But, he presented a show on the planets. And basically what he did was focus on the four inner planets, the four rocky planets.
Yes.
So that was Mars, Venus, Earth and... Mercury. Mm-hmm. Mercury
is
being the one.
David Attenborough?
No, this is...
it's not David Attenborough, but it's...
This is Dr. Brian Cox.
Brian Cox.
Hence the reason why I started singing Things Can Only Get Better.
Not to be confused with actor Brian Cox, which I often get confused every
well, that's
time.
Why
well,
I said
you
Dr.
Had
Brian
one
Cox.
Of my yes. friends in the studio. Mm-hmm. What's his name? Oh, the guy that...
We have had a number of people in the studio, but Bryn, I will get back to you.
Okay.
David, please, you were telling me about
Professor
Brian Cox.
Basically, what he was doing was turning around and exploring the entomology of the planet. Basically, sort of like the life and possible deaths of the planets, saying what will happen in billions of years' time when the hydrogen in the sun runs out.
Yes.
And the sun then turns into a red giant because basically it starts burning up the helium.
Yeah.
So it expands, cools down, but it also expands. So Mercury and Venus will disappear.
Mm-hmm.
Earth might disappear, but he then speculates on another moon near to Saturn that might then be capable of supporting life.
Oh, that's
so
cool.
It's really interesting.
It's interesting there because the moon was actually lower to the Earth than it's ever been at the Red Moon, wasn't it? The Wolf Moon.
Wow. Okay. So, I didn't know.
Yeah, the Wolf Moon, and it's actually had to drop lower to actually correct the stress that's going on in the planet and the universe because we're all moved by the moon, emotions, life, the sea is, and the tide, everything. So it's had to lower, so the moon's now nearer to us and close to us too. Okay. Actually,
well, one of the things,
the elements rule the world,
and that's
people
why
think the government rule the world, the elements rule the world. Mother Nature is the beast. Remember,
one of the things that you've got to understand is that the moon is moving away.
Icebergs melting.
Okay. Moon is moving away from the Earth at the rate of 3 centimeters per year.
So, yeah.
So basically, everything is moving well and truly away from the Earth, but that's going to take years for that to happen.
Okay, so just before you interrupt, I just want to ask this question: where did you see that? Where did you watch that?
I watched that on Catch Up.
It
was on Catch Up, but it's on, I think it's Tuesdays on BBC Two.
Okay, I was going to talk about the show that I watched, which is Good Omens on Amazon Prime, but we don't have time to go into that because
I've got Shudder free because they are a great person. Yes, because I have to review a movie for them, and they are great. Great, they've really bad movies, but hello there.
We will talk about that in just a minute.
Hold on, can I just say one thing? Watch Critters.
Bryn,
binge. That is awful.
Bryn,
they
hold on.
Critters.
Bryn, hold on 1 second. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus Iacco.
I'm David Campbell.
And with us in the studio, we have celebrity, ex Big Brother contestant. Lisa Appleton.
And she's spritzing Marilyn Monroe. And it's Bryn Curt James Hammond.
And Bryn's birthday today.
How is it?
June the 1st.
Well, okay.
Birthday, Marilyn.
The last time we had Bryn in the studio, and I mentioned this before the show, Bryn perfectly divided our audience 50-50. Ooh. It was 50% of our audience who said, we don't want to hear him ever again on the show.
Oh my God.
But
I would like to know who that half is.
But there were 50% accurate representation. 50% said, absolutely, you have to have him back on. And that's one of the reasons why Bryn is in here, because he cracks me up nonstop. Let's go into our next segment, which is film and TV news. Okay, so my corralling muscles are being flexed today. Oh, that's good. All right, no, it's all good. This is I enjoy this. I do enjoy this. All right, so film and TV news. We're going to use this opportunity and dedicate it just to our guests. We've got Lisa Appleton, Big Brother contestant.
I've been on 70 reality shows.
You've been on
prime time reality shows and documentaries. Hang on,
did you say seven or 70?
70.
Okay,
It's not just STEM Big Brother, it's reality shows, primetime and documentaries.
Excellent.
And being on BBC News.
We are going to talk about all of that in just a second. I just want to remind everyone, you listen to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. We have our guests in the studio. Our guests are Lisa Appleton and Bryn Curt James Hammond. Now, we'll do ladies first and we'll get... Absolutely. We'll focus... Don't say that. People are listening.
Oh, my God. She's got, like, legs that climb. Mariah Carey, eat your heart out.
Mariah Carey, if you're listening, eat your heart out.
I know.
But let's start with Lisa. So, Lisa, for those people who do not know you, please tell us, who is Lisa Appleton?
Lisa Appleton was born in 1968 on May the 22nd, and I was a successful athlete for athletic club in Warrington from the age of 7 till 15. And I won lots of medals from my clubs and my school with athletics. I left school, suffered depression and anxiety because I got injured and I packed all that in. And then I had my baby at 21 and then I was a professional bodybuilder.
She's very pretty.
At 27, I got myself really fit. I was very slim after my baby and built myself up bodybuilding and won shows. And I was just a normal down-to-earth girl that just, you know, I sold sandwiches, did cleaning jobs, I did all those things, bringing up my child, single parent. And then I got my lucky break on ITV in 1997. I was scouted for a TV show and they asked me to go on different shows. And my TV career sort of excelled after being on Big Brother.
Okay, so let me just stop
but
there.
I'm into fitness and health mainly.
So let me just stop there 1 second, just before. So your major break in TV was celebrity. Well, not celebrity, was Big Brother.
Big Brother.
I've always been very curious. What is the, and you've probably gotten this question tons of times, sort of what is the psychological makeup of someone who is in the Big Brother house? What happens to you as a person storming into that environment, being shut off from the rest of the world, even though you know the rest of the world is watching you? What sort of, walk us through that. What was it like being in the Big Brother house?
A lot of Big Brother contestants are just real, normal people that audition for the show, and they have this vision in their head that this is going to be like an amazing experience. It's something they want to do for whatever reason. You're just normal, real people, and it's genuine. And then the Big Brother is a game, basically. And you do sign that contract, and it is a manipulative game where it challenges every ounce of your mind, body and soul and spirit. And it's very difficult because you're cut off from your family, phones, TV, magazines, everything. You just don't know. You've just got no access to the outside world, and it's an experiment, basically. That's what Big Brother is. And it's how you cope.
But you enjoyed
in there.
It.
I was in there for 3 months and okay. I enjoyed it.
Okay. We will come back to you, Lisa, in a second, because I do want to explore more of what you did after the Big Brother house. But I want to jump into Bryn. Bryn. So the last time you were here, you came to publicize some of the books that you'd written. You came to talk about the Brittany Murphy files. Those of you who haven't listened to the previous show, okay. Bryn is a best-selling author.
Whole of horror inductee now, along with John Carpenter. Hello.
Hold on. Slow down, Bryn.
We should have some music for that one.
Calm down, Bryn. We need to reintroduce you to the public first, okay? So you're a best-selling author of the series of books, A Case for Murder.
One book.
Although there's the Anna Nicole Smith one,
no,
correct?
As I said to you, that was run by a different publishing house.
Sure, okay.
Which I then retook my control over because I was not happy with the way they edited my book and they put my book out.
Understood. But the one that you claim for yours is the Brittany Murphy files.
My bestseller is obviously Brittany Murphy.
Okay.
And then my recent one that came out was The Complete History of the Howling.
Yes.
Which sold exceptionally well, which sold everywhere, and it was great. And I worked with the guy that...
While you're thinking of that name, just for those who don't know about...
No, I didn't know his name.
Cokest.
No, wait, we won't go there. It's okay.
Don't
worry, I'll explain in a second. Just for those who are listening who don't know about The Howling, The Howling was a series of horror films.
With Dee Wallace.
Films. Yes, a series of...
Sybil Danning, who... is one of the most terrible actresses in the world. But, however, she makes a living from signing her books. But she worked with, Christopher Lee, and she's the only actress that had so long where she ripped her top off. It was 28 times, but they reduced it to a little time in the credits where she showed her breasts.
Understood. So just so that was the book that you did, The Complete History of the Howling.
Yes.
And then this is the bit where we're going to say something happened where you were now inducted into. Please tell us about this.
Oh, no. I was already inducted because of GZ Magazine, which I worked at the Playbill Mansion because of Gorzo Magazine.
So you were inducted into the Hall of Horror with John Carpenter. So the Hall of Horror, tell us what the Hall of Horror is.
Oh, you put your hand on a cement in Vegas. I sent you the pictures.
I understand, but we're getting you to tell the audience.
Okay. So in Vegas, there was what they call a festival. In October, where there's lots of things going on, and then famous people that work within the horror industry. Because before I started working as an author, I owned GZ Magazine, which was kind of Playboy for horror fans.
Sure.
So we did photo shoots with horror actresses, Bridget Marquardt. I'm probably still not pronouncing her name, but she was. Oh, my God, because I used to love watching the Girls of the Playbill Mansion. And Holly was my favourite, but when I filmed at the Playboy Mansion, and I met Bridget Holly. Really went down in my estimations because she was not a very nice person. But Bridget was cool.
Understood.
And we did lots of coolness. But yeah, anyway. But can I just say, anyway, I uploaded to my Twitter, which is Bryn CJ Hammond, today, one of my old Gorzone covers, which was in honour of Marilyn Monroe because it's her birthday,
today. You mentioned that, yes.
So, and we did, and at the time it was Freddy Krueger, the remake was coming out, but it was also Marilyn Monroe's birthday. So I got Susie Kennedy, which is a London-based woman who looks very similar to Marilyn Monroe.
Sure.
And we got her to do a shaving with Freddie's glove. And oh my God, I loved it. And do you know what? I think that is really iconic.
Excellent.
Having her gone. Sorry.
No. I was just going to say, that's excellent.
I've gone into writing, obviously. What was the question?
The question was, you were inducted into the Hall
of
Horror.
So yeah, because of my past, not because of my recent future.
Sure.
And all I did was speak to the press. Then I put my hand in a cement and I just did a wiggle with my finger along. Jeffrey Ridgett couldn't make it, who was from Final Destination. But John Carpenter was there. And what happened on that evening, which was very upsetting, is an aeroplane crashed opposite my brother's college in Leicester in the UK.
Okay.
Which was very upsetting. I'm not sure. It was not a tragic, but do you know when the US press, it was like it crashed and it burnt. But it was an aeroplane. It was on that evening where an aeroplane crashed. I was really upset. So
it's always a situation where something really significant, would come in and sort of change.
When I was on the news in the States, in Vegas, I cried, and it wasn't because I was upset. I was like, oh my God, I need to go.
Of course.
But my brother was okay.
That's great.
He's studying a great thing, and he's got a great girlfriend.
You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus Iacco.
And I'm David Campbell.
With us in the studio, we have celebrity reality TV show star Lisa Appleton and best-selling author Bryn Curt Hammond. Lisa, I want to come back to you. So you told us about your experience in the Big Brother house. What happened? What was sort of your work after Big Brother? So after you left the Big Brother house, what happened?
Well, just briefly, before Big Brother, I'm a massive character. Like, I'm here, there and everywhere, and I've always been a bit zany and crazy. And I was on 15 shows before Big Brother.
Okay.
And I was hitting magazines and press before Big Brother. And these shows were different, like quiz shows, or was on Fear Factor, and I've actually, an American producer voted me as the worst celebrity to be seen on TV in the world, beating Jackass.
Wow. Okay.
For eating a huge bull's testicle with 2 pints of posh word for spunk.
Okay, that's it's fine. That's
posh word
semen. Okay.
And a bullseye, and it was huge.
Wow. Okay.
And so this was before Big Brother.
Sure.
Not many people know that. So I told Big Brother that, and they were like, oh my God. And also, my partner, Mario, at the time, went to the, he was with Joe Pario, Sherio, with the chain gang.
He was good looking, though.
He went in the prisons for 2 years as a boot camp in Arizona to interview people on death row.
Okay.
And between us, we were like, I'd got that title on Fear Factor as the worst thing to be seen on the world on the World Sick TV. Mm-hmm. And we'd been on several TV shows. Well, I'd been on several before then. And then Big Brother was the one that got me. It got me recognised as what they call a celebrity.
Yes.
But don't forget, before then, you know, I didn't see myself as a celebrity, you know. I was just a normal person who liked to do normal things. The doors it opened, Big Brother, was amazing. Loads of TV shows after that, leading to a further 50, 60 reality TV shows, primetime and documentaries.
That's incredible.
I also fell.
Everybody.
I also end up on Benefits, rock bottom, homeless.
Bryn, just give me 1 second, okay? Just need to get
my story. It's a long, drawn out thing. You probably need about a year in this radio to actually talk about
it. Everyone had the best of intentions. However,
yes,
they didn't have anything to back it up. So anybody that...
It's fickle industry. It is. It's a fickle industry. Because what happens is when you go on these TV shows, whether it's Big Brother or Love Island, it soon dies a death, and then they're interested in the following year and those new fresh contestants. So my time was cut short, but I've done a lot of it myself. Okay. I've got myself on other shows.
And you've got a book as well.
Because of determination, I've got a book. I call my book Balls. I mean, I've had balls to do some of the things I've done. I mean, to eat a balls testicle, you know, you've got to have balls, haven't you?
It's a good reference back to the Fear Factor.
The worst thing to be seen on telly, never forget the worst. Never forget the worst dressed celebrity. I'm actually the worst celebrity in the world to be seen on TV for eating a balls testicle. So that's so my book's called Balls because I've achieved some things. But also,
she didn't mean this.
So we've got a control here. We've got a control here to go.
Bryn, if you give us 30 seconds, we'll come back to you, okay? I just want to wrap up with Lisa.
And then the book, Balls, is the abbreviation of those words is Beyond Anxiety, Love, Light, Success. Because like I said, I've been anorexic. I suffered anxiety as a teenager. And I built myself up as a successful and I won bodybuilding shows. So there's so many, much more to me than people realise. They see me larking around in the press. You know, but
she's got a great body. Book agents are absolutely amazing. You needed, like they couldn't supply, you know, agents can't supply everything. And I think, you know,
I'm drinking a Desperado.
All right, I'll tell you what, just before we come back to you, Lisa, I just want to conclude with you just one last second. So the book Balls is out at the moment. Where can people get that book?
No, it's not.
Is it not out yet?
Yes, Bryn.
It's been wrote at the moment.
Okay. It's been wrote at the
moment.
She's
working
with
Alex.
Okay.
Alex, and she's going to shoot because we're shooting our
which we will come to in just a second. So carry on. Okay. Tell us about the book first. So when can people get to read this book?
2020. But it's going to be Waterstones because Waterstones are very interested. We can't say they've signed a deal but they have said they're very interested.
Okay.
So the wholesale system has said yay, and now I probably shouldn't have said that, but yes.
Okay. I'll tell you what. Let's rope that bit in first because we want to go into the next segment, which is about the both of you.
Can we stop for a second?
Not a second. No, it's okay. It's okay. Don't worry about it. So we're going to rope this into the next segment, which is Spotlight. Listen to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus Iacco.
And I'm David Campbell.
Okay, so with us in the studio, we have Lisa Appleton, former Big Brother contestant, as well as reality TV show star, and writer, author, Bryn Curt James Hammond. You're both working on a new project at the moment, right? Lisa, can we start with you? What is the project called?
The project is called, and I'm so excited, Pop Culture Pulse.
Pop Culture Pulse.
And it covers Pop Culture Pulse. Whoa!
So what is Pop Culture Pulse?
And it covers movies, TV, films, music, pop culture, everything that the whole world tunes into on a daily basis, because we all tune into TV, films, soaps, you name it, documentaries, celebrities, huge. We tune into it day in, day out, and this is what the show's about. But we're taking it to another level. It's never been done before, and I'm very excited for this opportunity. Thank you, Bryn. I love
him. Don't be silly. It's a teamwork.
And it's teamwork.
So we've got Stephen, who's from 20th Century Geek. He's a podcaster. He's absolutely fabulato. And we've, all three of us, we're going to really work really hard to bring the public what they want. It's going to be a pilot for the first one. Mm-hmm. And we've got three options. So Well, they know their options because they've already put the bids in.
Sure.
So the one with the biggest bid, then they can take it from us.
So for the audience that are listening right now who've never heard of Pop Culture Pulse,
okay.
So what is Pop Culture Pulse? You say it's about celebrities, TV shows. What sort of structure and how are you two connected
structure,
to it?
Right.
The whole media, isn't
we're
it?
We're the hosts along mm-hmm. with Stephen.
Okay.
All three of us are going to be covering our main features. Like, I can cover what I enjoy.
Mm-hmm.
She'll cover what she enjoys.
I'm going to be gracing the red carpet.
Okay,
I know.
So you'll be doing
and
red carpet interviews?
Celebrities.
Excellent.
Do you
okay.
know...
And locations all around the UK and Los Angeles and around the world.
Yeah.
And really interviewing everybody for their most upbeat, utmost kind of what's
and
going
sticking
on
a
in
rude
this
thing
industry
in their mouth.
Of Pop Culture Pulse.
Understood.
And I cannot wait.
So when is the first episode recording?
Right. Well, we're going to start filming this month,
yep.
because we're in June now,
mm-hmm.
I was talking to, which is on my phone, I can tell you direct
sure,
dates.
Absolutely.
And he's fabulato. She's going to stay at the apartment, which is so fabulato.
Okay.
And then
fabulato,
we...
Fabulato, I like that.
I know.
Sounds like a fart, doesn't it?
Which one?
It's okay.
Oh, my gosh.
Fabulato.
No, because our first thing
Look,
is...
expect some action in this show. We've got
sure.
a... We've got a
not rude. It's not going to be rude.
No, but it's like umph it up. What's
okay.
that word, umph it? Is it umph?
I'm not entirely sure. Pump it up.
Pump it up.
Pump it up, not umph.
We've started to film already.
Oh,
Stephen's filmed
started.
In Nottingham. I don't know exactly the internet, but on Tuesday,
yeah.
we're going to start filming. We're going to the Spice Girls
Spice
concert.
Excellent. So are you going to be doing
Mel
any,
B.
Are you going to be
I
doing,
know.
Let me ask. Are you going to be doing any interviews?
Well, it's
this?
A press pass.
Sure. So,
hello. So I'm Mel B.
Absolutely. I'll be like...
She's going to be
I'm
my Ginger
have
Spice.
My microphone.
I know. Hold
Here's
on.
My phone.
No.
I'm going to say, hi.
Listen,
oh, my God. I need to interview.
I'm Mel B.
I've met Justin Bieber now. Now,
okay.
if I've met Justin Bieber and chatted to him... I can chat to Spice
I love
girls.
Mel B.
Sure.
So I'm Mel B. This is...
She's
I
like,
needed...
Oh, she's like so funny, isn't she?
I needed my Ginger Spice. Quickly.
So this is basically what you're going to be expecting when you get to see the show
Madness.
Pop Culture
okay.
Pulse, which is going to be coming out in 2020.
No, this is not going to be. We are caned at the moment.
Sure.
But we are happy caned, but our TV show is going to cover literally everything that the geek wants.
Yes.
But they won't have to leave their bedroom.
Sure.
So they just need to get that Kleenex.
Mm-hmm.
And they're going to have to listen to me, Lisa, and Stephen climbing hills just for them.
Understood. As soon as those shows are
love
out
it.
And ready,
She's
we will...
there, Tomb Raider.
We will provide all
Absolutely.
The information that you need.
And I'm there, Keith.
Yes, we will provide all the information you need about that particular show to check it out. Lisa and Bryn, thank you very much. Now we're going to move
thank
on
you.
To our next segment because I know we're
okay.
running out of time. Our next segment is Top 5 Favorites. Wow. So a lot of, yeah, it's okay. A lot of confusion going on because everyone is so excited to talk about the next segment, which is top five favorites. So. I'm gonna say this. We've been doing this show for a year and a half, and nobody has been that excited to do their top five favorite category. Our top five favorite category this week is top five favorite film, TV, or anything based on reality TV. So any films that are about reality TV shows, any TV shows that are about reality TV shows, or just reality TV shows in general. So we're gonna go. I'm gonna snap my finger. I won't snap my finger. That'd just be too rude. I'm just trying to get Bryn's attention. So What we're going to do is we're going to go around the room. We'll start
with... Don't make them hate me. They already... I'm 50-50.
Yeah, right. The other 50 will change their mind.
The ones that don't like me, put me in the room for 5 minutes and I bet they'll all want to hook me after 2 minutes. I can guarantee that.
I won't put money on that bet. Anyway, so we're going to go around the room and we'll start with our lady guest, Lisa, who's going to tell us her number five and number four option. We'll go around to Bryn, then David, then myself, and then we'll come around right until we get to number one. So let's start with the lady. Lisa, what is your number five and your number four favorite film, TV, reality show based?
My favourite at the minute is Britain's Got Talent, because it really gives the general public, who are just real lovely people, a chance to display their skills, their entertainment, and I love it. It's just, it totally makes my night. Everybody loves it.
Who's your favourite judge?
Amanda Holden.
Okay.
I love her. I love David Walliams, but I love Amanda Holden. I think she speaks so well. She's beautiful. She's very energetic. I watch it because Amanda's on it as well.
Sure.
And I think she's loving Simon Cowell. He's great fun, and David Walliams, but Amanda's my favourite.
Excellent. So what's your number four?
Number four is ITN News. No, I'm only joking.
Hey, that could be your favourite reality TV show as well, if that's what you want. It has a lot of drama in it. But what is your number four?
My number four is I Love Davina McCall, Long Lost Families.
Long Lost Families.
Yeah, because it reunites people with, you know, a loved one that they've lost and they haven't seen. And it's just so emotional, and it gives people the opportunity to find their lost family members.
Is that on BBC Two?
It's on BBC Channel.
I think I know the one you're talking about. It is very emotional, where you have
it's emotions. I think emotions touch people. It's like Britain's Got Talent. They have stories, some of them, and it really touches your heart. And people have these real life experiences, and they get a chance to talk about it and share it, and it touches the nation. So emotions are very... I'm connected to emotions, and I think the general public are as well, because it's everyday life, isn't it? We're not robots, we're humans who have these...
It just depends, doesn't it? We don't want a sad story like X Factor, where someone goes, oh, I've just farted, and oh my God, I've got an eye.
Yeah, just checks it's on
and
ITV.
And then it always goes, right, and then they go at the
BBC,
end of it, call me,
it's on ITV.
Because they do, don't they?
Okay, so thanks. Right. One second. So Lisa, thank you very much for your number five and number four. Bryn, what's your number five and number four?
I would say Dead Set.
Dead Set. Tell us what Dead
Set
is.
Because that's a fabulato reaction to reality TV done by Charlie Brooker, who's my friend, who's on my phone, and he's great. Well, I'm not sure if he slept with her, but when I met her, he was with Ashley. Ashley! We were talking about her today, didn't we? Ashley!
Yeah,
Dessa is kind of like...
Yeah, she's lovely.
Big brother,
I like her.
But zombies... I met her and she was all right.
Yes.
I just don't
sexy.
Get where she's...
Bryn, that's her.
Okay, sorry. Zombies attack the big brother
One second, Bryn. There's like the 50% of the audience is like saying, yes, producer Dave, do your job.
Oh my God, but everyone's probably with me with when she's on Instagram.
Bryn,
she's like,
Bryn,
and I'm like, what?
Bryn, that's her.
Okay, Zedsa is literally the Big Brother house, but the zombies attack the world, and the only people survive.
And that's your number five. Bryn, what's your number four?
Now, my number four is the one with Edward Furlong, which has Jamie Lee Presley, and it's called Scream. But it's also got three different titles.
Okay.
It's Cruel World as well, it's called. And it's a bunch of celebrities, but it's not real celebrities, obviously.
Sure, of course.
It's kind of like the Big Brother thing.
Okay.
It's got Suzanne Ward from Sunset Beach.
Yes.
She's so cute.
I liked her.
I know she's so cute. She had a breast implant, and I was like, oh my God, clap, clap, clap. She's so pretty. Anyway, there was loads of good looking people in that movie, and Edward Furlong literally one by one killed them. And it was kind of like, I know, it was kind of like Big Brother, similar to Dead Set, but sure. It's reality TV. So okay. Yeah.
So it's like a whodunit set in Big Brother.
No, because he's behind the camera and he tells them he's killing them, and if they don't take part in a game, then they're going to die.
Oh, so you know from the get-go that he's the one that's killing people.
Well, yeah, because he's fat and obese sitting behind cameras. And he's like, blah, blah, blah. So, yeah.
Okay.
David, I know he's lost his looks. That's why he's not in the new Terminator.
Let's throw this to David. David, what's your number five? What's your number four?
Well, compared to the last four that we just heard, mine are just going to be boring. My number five is Alaskan Bush People. I've been watching a lot of, what's it called?
Alaskan Bush People.
Yeah, Alaskan Bush People. I've been watching a lot of D-Max, and they do nothing but reality things. So it's about a family of nine who live out in the Alaskan bush.
Yeah.
And they're basically trying to eke a living out there. But this lot are kind of weird because they seem to have tragedy follow them every step of the way, so they keep having to move.
Yeah, so it's kind of like D-Max tend to do reality shows where they focus like 16 Kids and Counting and so on, where they focus on a family and that kind of stuff. TLC, yeah.
Honey Boo Boo.
Yes.
So my number four, yes, again, staying with D-Max.
1 second, let's hear David's number four.
Is Alaska Last Frontier. Now, this is slightly different.
What is with you in Alaska?
Yeah, I know. Beautiful scenery, I'm telling you. Alaska Last Frontier is basically focused on a family called the Kilchers who have a homestead in Alaska. Okay. And the grandfather, blah, 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 left Sweden at the time of Hitler's uprising up there and moved to Alaska, established a homestead, and it's just basically them subsisting on the land.
Okay.
Basically.
Is that like reality or real life?
It's kind of it's reality stroke real life, isn't it? So yeah, it's more reality than sort of like some of the other programs that has been on, because they actually live through it.
Now,
so
it's not. I've got like. Yeah.
Go on. No, I was just going to say it's not an orchestrated set of events for things to happen to build attention.
Do you know what? I've watched a couple of series now.
Yeah.
And for me, I think
Hitler's been dead for a long time.
I think for me, I think the initial first series was reality,
sure.
And then the rest of them are okay. It is real, but we want you to do this, or we want this to happen, and we want you to.
So you can see the producer fingerprints manipulating situations to build drama.
Well, if you think of Made in Chelsea, I think it's the kind of similar.
I think that's probably a real Made in Chelsea is probably not that, because my friend works on Made in Chelsea, and it's probably not that. But now you've said what those two shows are, I'm kind of thinking Honey Boo Boo.
Okay. So we'll come back to yours, Bryn, and maybe you can involve Honey Boo Boo.
I'm very interested in
that.
Well, don't worry. I'll tell you all about it afterwards. Okay. I'll show you the pictures as well.
So let me go through my number five and my number four. My number five has already been mentioned. Dead Set. I love Charlie Brooker's writing.
Should we call him?
Not on air.
Not now.
We can call him afterwards. We can call him afterwards, and you can make an introduction, and it'll be fine. But yeah, I love Dead Set. I love Black Mirror. I love a lot of the stuff that he does. But Dead Set was basically, I mean, you described it, where it's basically, it's focusing on the Big Brother house with contestants in there.
Like Davina, and they kill.
Yeah, and then the zombie apocalypse happens around them.
Which is a bit of a tosser.
My number four is Running Man, The Running Man. Which is the Arnold Schwarzenegger vehicle from 1987. And it's basically, if you haven't seen it, it's futuristic setting.
Hang on, isn't that a Stephen King film?
It's Stephen King book. Yes. It's based on a Stephen King book where contestants basically, same thing as reality shows where it's like a reality game show where contestants go in there and they undergo certain obstacles in order to win this enormous escape to paradise.
And it had Sharon Stone in one of her earliest roles.
Are you sure Sharon Stone was in that one? Are you sure she was not in Total Recall? Exactly.
Sorry.
Not a problem. Anyway, so that's my number five and number four.
I
Dead Set and Running Man. So we're going to come to Bryn in a few minutes. This is Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acker.
And I'm David Campbell.
We have Lisa Appleton in the studio with us, who's going to tell us her number three and number two top five favorites reality TV show categories. So what is your number three and number two?
My number three is Gogglebox, because I feel Gogglebox covers, it's just the general public watching our TV our TVs, yes. which covers everything, mm-hmm. doesn't it? From every reality show to every film. It's amazing. And I think it's they're just so hilarious, their take on it and the views on it. And it just works. It's brilliant.
Here's my... I don't have a problem with Gogglebox at all, because I agree with you. The characters on there are very funny. What triggers me about Gogglebox is the meta nature of Gogglebox. The show Gogglebox is about people watching other shows, right?
It's so very condescending.
Well, it's like Big Brother in your lounge, yes, in your private home.
Yes.
Watching your views on it's we all sit there, don't we? Like say you're watching whatever show it is, whether it's Big Brother, I'm Celebrity, yes. or blah blah. You sit there and go, oh, well, why is she doing that? And why is he doing that? And
no, I agree with that.
It's funny.
I agree with that.
That's how we are.
My issue with it is the extra meta level of it, where if I were to sit down watching Gogglebox, I'm effectively watching a group of people sitting down watching TV.
Have you watched Gogglebox?
I
mean?
I have. Yeah. That's so the reason why.
It's gone from the outside in.
Yes.
I think it's very clever. I
agree with you.
Anyway,
I agree with you. But that's great. So that's your number three. What's your number two?
My number two is I absolutely love conspiracy theories.
Okay.
I'm absolutely mad on documentaries, conspiracy theories around the world, things, because we all get washed up with all this reality TV and soap stars, and we get distracted with, you know, the general things going on in our lives and on our TV. But conspiracy theories, Vessie Ventura in particular, I loved hers because it just displayed that let's get behind the scenes, the reality of what's really going on in the world and what is possibly going on in the world, and it's conspiracy. And I absolutely think it's important to not get carried away, swept away with our everyday life, watching telly, thinking, oh, blah, 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 and distracted. You've got to know what's actually going on behind the scenes. And conspiracy theories is on the nail.
I've seen one episode of that show, and that's the episode, the 9/11 episode.
Have you watched me, though?
Not you on... Mm-hmm. Well, that's different. So the conspiracy theories with Jesse Ventura, I've seen one episode of that. Mm-hmm. I see your point, and I completely agree with you. If you mm-hmm. are that way inclined, if you like conspiracy theories, then that will appeal to you. The one thing I didn't like about that film, or about that show, was the way it was, the way it was edited. And it's sort of, if to win over someone like me, who is not necessarily, you know, drawn against like conspiracy theories, it's sort of, if it's highly produced, I will reject your concept. So do you understand what I mean? So in a sense where, I'll just give you... I'll explain this. One of the reasons why is I went to watch that show fully, you know, mm-hmm. receptive to them trying to convince me that the 9/11 issues were faked, right? But because it was overly produced, you have situations where a witness is being talked to and they're cutting and editing and the camera is just to try and create that drama of the witness walking out. I'm watching it thinking, no, you're just trying to build up unnecessary drama. Just have a simple sit-down conversation with this witness. Let me see it and understand what you're saying, instead of being made to feel that way. Do you see what I mean? But that's just me. That's just my issue. Thank you very much. That's your number three. That's your number two. Conspiracy theories with Jesse Ventura. Your number three was Gogglebox. Bryn, let's go to you. We're coming to you, Bryn. What's your number three? What's your number two?
Let me just say about that. In terms of what you said, I think a lot of things are edited depending on who they're trying to appeal to. So that's great. But that's why she enjoyed them, because they edited it towards conspiracy.
I never mentioned 9/11. You brought that up. The shows I've watched covers just everything, like to our food, what's happening to our food, what's happening to our water, what's happening to our environment.
But they did
the environment in the world, the damage that's been done.
I know, but they did say...
Bryn, one second. Lisa's just...
Yeah, and it's all those things that I'm interested in, is keeping the planet mm-hmm. and the world as alive, healthy, functioning as nature intended, than making it, you know, people need to be aware of these mm-hmm. things. And the conspiracy theory is that, you know, food's being messed up, processed foods.
Not all the time, though.
She's just talking about this particular show.
Yeah.
Medication that we're taking, whatever it is, life. And people get, you know, swept away with all the you know, general things, distractions in life, whereas we need to stay grounded and based into the natural way of life, how with nature intended. That's what I'm saying. It's not so much about what happened on that.
No, no, no. That was a big topic,
and I won't go there, to be honest with you.
No, I was just bringing up that one episode, and that's what turned me off, that show in particular.
I'm into holistic route in life and stuff. And
Bryn?
I actually think I really love the YouTube channel.
Is this your number three?
Number three, Judy James. I don't even know if she's, but she's a YouTube channel, and at the moment she's talking about the Chris Watts case, which I watch unstoppably, which is reality, because she's watching the court case going on, similar to the Jodi Arias case. She's talking about it every single. She goes, "Hello, I'm Judy, whatever her name is," on on YouTube, and she's live. And that's kind of reality, because I'm watching her.
Sure.
She's watching the court case.
Understood.
That is reality. So
that's your number three. What's your number two?
Right, my number two would probably have to be Cruel Intentions.
Okay.
No, not Cruel Intentions. In Crowd.
In Crowd, yeah.
Okay. Because that is... It's not a reality TV show, but it's kind of... similar to what Lisa said in certain aspects of the things that she said, you're looking from the exterior on the interior, but someone's telling the story, which was told by Mary Lambert, who did the original Pet Sematary, whose, well, the new Pet Sematary was terrible. Okay.
I haven't seen it yet, but that's a good thing that you brought that up, because I did want to ask you, but we didn't get the chance to, when I was going to get your
film. She did part one and part two.
Okay.
And she did like a social experiment with her movie. And I think, yay. So that was my number two.
Okay, cool. Excellent. So your number three was Judy James on YouTube, and your number two was, you said, The In Crowd.
Yeah, my number one would probably be
The Debacle. We ain't got there yet. Stop jumping the gun.
Everybody just jumped into that.
We don't want no prematureness here.
I know. Oh, you dirty bugger.
What do you mean?
David, what's your number three and what's your number two?
My number three is back to Alaska again. Life Below Zero.
Seriously, what is your deal with Alaska? Are you trying to tell us something?
I'm actually. Do you know what? Beautiful landscape.
Where did that come from?
Always. She likes everything he's just said.
Okay.
Literally.
Oh, how do you
she's
know?
She's watching every film, the TV show. My mum watches them, and literally, she's like, "Ooh, what did you think, Bryn?" I'm like. No, I haven't
watched it. There you go, Dave.
Okay, fine.
We've got a suitor.
Anyway.
So it's Below Zero?
Life Below Zero. Basically, again, back to Alaska. Beautiful landscapes and everything else like this, but a different storyline. It focuses on about five different families, and it's their life below zero, basically, because you see where they live is either just south or just north of the polar cap. The polar line.
Sure.
And there's this one lady called Sue. She's in her mid 50s. She lives by herself. Mm-hmm. She has this great big station which she manages by herself. So she gets all the fuel in, she feeds herself, she clothes herself. She has to make plans to make sure that the fuel is delivered in time. It is just fascinating to watch, to be quite honest. I must admit, I've only watched one episode.
And that's on D-Max as well?
Not one episode, one series. And that is on D-Max.
Okay.
Can you do it as a bulk watch?
Sorry?
Yeah, you can you could go on D-Max. I'm sure D-Max have a catch-up.
No, they don't.
They
probably have on Sky, but I don't have that.
Yeah, okay, fair enough. So,
do you know binge-watching? Because I do those binge-watching.
Yeah, because they'll have like the catch-up.
I was actually going to watch it tomorrow.
Possibly, yeah.
Okay, so what's your number two?
RuPaul's Drag Race.
No way.
Okay, I'm going to write this down and I'm going to say it right, because the last time that we had Harvey Halfpenny come in, I could not say this
that
properly.
That is the reason why I started watching. I watched a few of
RuPaul's Drag Race.
RuPaul's Drag Race. Great. And Mr. Halfpenny sold it to me.
Yes.
You know, he's a...
Would you like to listen to one of the I Can Actually Call?
No,
we're fine.
No, carry on. RuPaul's Drag Race, because he turned around and talked about it so much, I decided to watch a couple of episodes.
Okay.
And I got a couple of friends who turned around and said to me, had been saying to me, you would really enjoy this.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not that into drag, but the whole concept of it was hilarious.
Okay. My friend's got two movies out of RuPaul's Drag Race, and I've only watched... He's on my phone. I've never watched it.
Haven't you? It's
never. Oh, my God.
Well,
what?
I'm actually surprised.
No, it's not my thing.
Really?
Yeah.
You sure?
No.
Well, okay. Anyway.
All right, so number three was Life Below Zero.
Well, and
your number
two was...
I love it. I've actually met him.
Yeah, oh, you have?
Lestrange, what's she called now?
I remember there was one. I remember there was one English guy.
Evandra in Los Angeles last year.
Is that a contestant on RuPaul's Drag Race?
Yeah,
okay.
She's huge. Yeah.
Okay. I've got the black.
I remember there was one contestant who was English, who was on
and
there
it's
as well.
Far fly,
but the thing was, he lost, and and then at the end of it, he explained the reason why, the difference, because it was I think it was a sing off at the end.
Okay.
And the thing is, the English drag artists sing.
Yeah.
And the American ones, mime.
Sure.
So, you know.
Okay.
Anyway.
Well, you want to... Yes, yes. Bryn's going to have some food while I go through my number three and my number two.
I'm not eating anything.
You're not eating anything. Okay.
Anyway, number three.
So,
number two?
My number three is a show on Amazon Prime called Unreal. You've watched Unreal.
I know.
So for those of you who don't know what Unreal is, Unreal is behind the scenes of a reality TV show, kind of like The Bachelor or The Bachelorette. And the show itself within the show is a bachelor type setting where 10 women go into a house and they have to fight for the attention of a bachelor. And the main protagonist of the show is a producer on the show, as well as the creator of the show. So you get to see what happens. So this is one of the reasons why, Lisa, I was interested in finding out more of your experience going into the Big Brother house, and wondering how producers would try and poke and needle you to try and get certain reactions in order to create drama. We didn't get the chance to talk about that. I hope you can come back on the show and we can talk a little bit more about that if you are interested. But we can talk about that another time.
Of course, yeah.
Excellent.
Food and sleep deprivation.
Yes, we'll do that without any interruptions. We're talking about that. My number two is EdTV. EdTV is a Ron Howard movie with Matthew McConaughey and Woody Harrelson. It's basically follows a character, Ed, who he signs his life rights away so that he can be followed by camera so that they can watch him 24/7. You know, just doing everything. And at first it seems like a great idea, and then it starts to spiral out of control. I really like it. I like Matthew McConaughey. I like Ron Howard. And it came after what my number one is, which I'll talk about in a second. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm David Campbell.
And we're going to go to Lisa Appleton, reality TV show star, who's going to tell us her number one favorite film, TV, or reality TV show. What is your number one favorite?
Joanne Bennett.
Go on. What is your number one?
Obviously, being on Big Brother, I'm a massive Big Brother star. I love I'm a Celebrity. I love all those things, seeing, you know, celebrities go through that. But my number one thing, and it might be deviating away from what you've said, is documentaries about charity.
Nice. Okay.
Yeah, about charity, about we need to, as much as we can get, you know, swept away with these reality shows, it's good to remember that throughout the world there's people suffering.
Do you have any in particular that you would like to, that you want to give a shout out to?
Yeah, my dad in particular. He, for many, many years, built a village up in Ethiopia.
Okay.
I'm very proud of that. He's passed over now, bless him, but he'd done that all his life. He paid into it and he built a village up and for water, food, and they grew their vegetables and stuff. And for me, documentaries, we've got to stay grounded and remember that behind all this, what I can class as fake and false.
Yeah.
At times, is there's a world out there suffering, and I'm reaching out to that. Those are the best shows. Let's
forget
go for
the
it.
TV.
Thank you very much
it's
for that.
It's great.
Bryn, let's jump to you. What's
Joanne
number one?
Bennett, casting Joanne Bennett, which was the young child which was murdered, but they had a documentary of casting the actress to play the child in a. Which was on Netflix. I thought it was very distasteful, but I thought it was very interesting.
Okay.
I like to watch the entirety of the casting process.
Okay, yay. Perfect. David, what's your number one?
Naked Attraction.
Tell us about it really quickly.
Oh, no.
It's basically, it's a reality.
Oh, I know the one. Yes, yes.
Oh, my God.
It's someone goes along and chooses someone to go on a date with based on their nakedness. So
that's part of it, yes, but they do reverse
as well. Oh, my God, no. She goes, look at your boobies, look at your dingo.
Actually, she goes through everything, and she, like she goes...
She doesn't show the face, does she?
Like she says, she likes Martha and Arthur, so she don't care.
Yes.
I got asked to go on that, you know. I was offered quite a big money for that. And actually, believe it or not, as wild as I am, I declined.
Oh, okay. Well, my number one is The Truman Show, 1998. Jim Carrey, he grows, the character Truman lives in this bubble. He does not know that everyone around him is an actor, and he's living in an enclave, which basically his entire life is kind of like the Big Brother house, except he is literally the only person that doesn't know he's in a reality TV show. You've been listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. Lisa Appleton, I want to thank you very much for joining us and spending this hour with us and telling us
about
your experience. We definitely...
Thank you so much.
We'd love to. One second.
2020.
We'd like to welcome you back whenever you want to. Bryn, it's always been a pleasure for me to bring you back into the studio because I know there are people pulling their hairs out, but I love it when you come on the show. Thank you very much for joining us. And everyone, we will be back next week. So tune in. You can hit us on Facebook. It's all about the three-way. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
I'm David Campbell.
Thank you very much for listening.
And
see you next week.
If you're enjoying this wonderful broadcast from Resonance 104.4 FM, please help keep us on air by donating. For more information, visit www.resonancefm.com.